I never expected to make an episode of It's Pittsburgh about Millvale. But I just dropped off my income taxes in the North Hills and was driving south on Babcock Boulevard, which eventually becomes Evergreen Avenue. You get to a fork where you can bear left and stay on Evergreen, sort of skirting around Millvale, or bear right onto North Avenue heading into the Millvale Business District. I decided to go right, thinking I don't often get to Millvale, and if there's a convenient parking space, maybe I'll stop at the French Bakery. Millvale is an unassuming borough just outside the Pittsburgh city limits, but it's got an incredible French Bakery where you can get stupendous baked goods that can make you believe you're not too far from Paris. I thought maybe I'd treat myself. Well, one thing led to another, and a story I'd planned to shoot in McKeesport had to be canceled. And before I knew it, I was finding lots of interesting things in Millvale. I was watching people make candies and talking about turtle soup. I was looking for music and found out about the hobby shop and the Lincoln Pharmacy with its world-famous diner, and people surviving the flood. All of a sudden, I was putting together a program I wanted to call The Joys of Millvale. But I just have half an hour, and you can't put a whole town in a half hour. We're going to look at just a few of the many reasons you might like Millvale. I know there are many more.
It's Pittsburgh and a lot of other stuff is made possible by the Buell Foundation, serving southwestern Pennsylvania since 1927. And by PNC, celebrating Pittsburgh's past, present, and future at the PNC Legacy Project exhibit in downtown Pittsburgh.
So let's start at that bakery on North Avenue. It's called Jean-Marc Chatelier's French Bakery.
People remember Jean-Marc's. They don't know the last name. Like if you go somewhere else, they'll say, oh, that French bakery in Millvale. Oh, Jean-Marc's, that's it.
Jean-Marc gets here before dawn most days. He was rolling out dough when we arrived one Tuesday about 7 a.m.
See, that's the French rolling pin. That's the American rolling pin. Actually, I like this one better. Well, I'm from Brittany, next in a tiny little village on the northwest coast, about half an hour from the ocean.
This multi-layered dough is for the simple flaky treats that some Americans call elephant ears, although they're also known by their French name, palmiers.
That's a big French classic breakfast pastry. They are very tricky to make, but I've been making them long enough now.
Jean-Marc came to America in the 1980s, worked on Cape Cod, then for years in Los Angeles, and he married a girl from Shaler, who eventually convinced him to move here and open this bakery.
She did push me and more and more and more and more. And then I say, it's not going to work. It is not going to work. She said, it will work. And then I say, okay.
There always seemed to be five or six tasks underway. Listening for timers, running to get things out of the ovens.
Look at that.
The business opened in 1992, wholesale only at first, but soon with the retail shop up front. It was a surprise in Millvale.
Well, a lot of people ask me, what am I doing here? Yeah. But actually, it's a very good location. Because like when I was doing my wholesale business, if you take the map of Allegheny County, Millvale is exactly in the center. And people will travel.
They'll definitely travel. We have people that come from Ohio for his croissants. They'll call me and ask me to put them aside because they're on their way. They love his stuff. Everybody does. His stuff is really good.
Cindy Sykoski lives right around the corner and has worked for Jean-Marc for over 15 years.
My favorite thing is the cinnamon croissant. It's just my favorite.
Yes, and
Jean-Marc says I eat six of them a day, but that's not true. That's what he tells all the customers, because they're always the first ones that are gone. And he always tells them that's because I eat them.
Cinnamon croissants. If you made that in France, you wouldn't sell one. Zero. Why? Because French people don't like cinnamon.
As a young man, Jean-Marc did an apprenticeship in France to learn how to make all these stupendous baked goods. And those skinny little V-shaped things, they've become beautiful palmiers.
All right. Look at that. I get an A+ today.
And he makes killer croissant.
But then I mix it up. You have to you have to go with the flow, you know. It's not all French. That's why my business card says American and European pastries. Because we make everything, you know. Like today we don't have brownies, but we sell a lot of brownies, lots of brownies. We have the Lady Locks. We sell so many Lady Locks.
But for the past few years, some of the biggest selling items here are the multicolored, many-flavored, little almond cookie sandwiches known as macarons, sort of cousins to macaroons.
There's macaroons and macarons. We make macarons also, and I love them. There's 2 O's for the macaroons and 1 O for the macaron. But when they come here, it's Millvale. They just call it the French macarons. That's it. It's whipped egg whites with sugar. Almond flour and sugar. That's all there is in it. It's gluten-free, but it's very important. There is some technique to mix the egg whites. That's why they are very difficult to make. Everybody has their own little tricks, and I won't let you know which one they are.
Of course, flavors and colors are added. And although they are remarkably uniform in appearance, Jean-Marc makes them all by hand, carefully piping out the dough as if he were a machine. But he knows exactly how long to bake them and how long they have to sit before you can attempt to put the filling between two cookies. And he pays special attention to the little ragged bottom edges of each cookie.
When you look at it, there is the feet. You see that little feet there? That's what you know it's a nice macaron. That's how people judge in France. Look at the feet. I know I'm the only one who makes the real true French macaron in Pittsburgh. So that's why that brings a lot of people to Millvale. Just for those little buggers there.
I think people find lots of reasons to come to Millvale. Just across the street and a few doors down, there's a yellow brick structure that serves several purposes.
A lot of people come here and they're trying to find the Pamela's restaurant and they're confused that it's inside a pharmacy. People here in the community call the business the Lincoln. I'm going to the Lincoln to get a prescription, or I'm going to the Lincoln to eat breakfast.
So Jennifer Cohen here oversees this hybrid, half drugstore, half restaurant, the restaurant officially called Pamela's P&G Diner.
P is for Pamela, G is for Gail. I continue to call it the soda fountain, but most people don't know what a soda fountain is anymore. And through the years, we've expanded and expanded and expanded the pharmacy. And my sister Pam from Pamela's restaurant, Pam and Gail, I asked them about 15 years ago if they would manage the soda fountain and come in and put in their menus. They are the chefs and the family.
And it's their food that sometimes attracts prominent out-of-towners.
Oh, we've had a lot of famous visitors here. I guess the one that we're really known for is Michelle Obama coming here. And it was during the G20 summit that she actually came and had breakfast here.
Open since 1928, the Lincoln has become a Millvale landmark thanks largely to the Cohen family, including Jennifer.
I asked my father if I could learn about the business, and he said, if you want to do that, and I've been here ever since. And I'm third generation here in the pharmacy business, and I love it. I have a lot of photos. In 1968, Millvale was 100 years old, and my father was president of the Millvale Centennial.
And he helped put together a centennial booklet full of town history and photos. This part of the world was first known to Europeans as Gertie's Run, after the stream named for the Gertie family that included the notorious traitor Simon Gertie. Millvale is situated along Gertie's Run just before it flows into the Allegheny River. In 1853, a small steel mill was built near the river, and the mill in the beautiful valley or vale of Gertie's Run eventually combined to create the name Millvale in 1868. People have been finding things to do here ever since. If you're on North Avenue, you may notice a white bench that says Relax with a Hobby. I think it may be the best sidewalk bench in Pennsylvania. It's outside the hobby shop called Esther's, founded by Esther Mailer.
That was my mom, yeah. 1938, she started here. Because I'm a Depression kid, and my father left when I was a month old, so she had to do something to feed me. I got tired crying. It took me 6 years or 7 years before she listened to me, though, cry, see. So she opened a store to feed us both. And I got stuck with the place after she died. She stiffed me with it, see.
We'll get him a Corvette. We'll get a, what's here. This one here? Yeah,
that's Pontiac Goat.
GTX.
Does that sound all right?
Yeah, that sounds good.
Okay. I'm only going to hit you up for like 20 bucks.
Cool.
Is that good enough?
Yep.
Hobby shops are such an extinct business in today's world. The only competitor I have is the internet.
Well, I had a question between like the double ones and the single ones.
There used to be 28 of us in Allegheny County, and now there's three.
If you're thinking eventually getting a third train, definitely go with the single one.
I see what you're saying.
Okay.
All right. Well, that helps answer some questions. I'll do some thinking now.
All right. You're allowed to think.
So what exactly is it that Bob Mailer sells in this old hobby shop?
Hobbies. How can I describe one product in here? There's, you know, 5,000 different products in here, from a rocket ship to an antique train to, tell me something else, guys.
There's a million things. I don't
there,
know.
Gee, I said thousands.
You don't have to look at it. I'm still counting them all.
Yeah. In other words, it's what's called detailing in miniature. The N-scale model railing stands for nice scale. Purists will tell you it's 9 millimeters between the rail, but it stands for nice. Like HO is half of O gauge, but there are people that think it just stands for horribly oversized, too.
Now, depending on your attitude and Bob's mood, if you're fortunate, you may get invited to see the N-scale layout in the basement here.
No, it's just done by what's called the steel ton end scalers. It's a group of about 8 people that enjoy doing model railroading.
This is awesome.
Eventually, it's going to be around the whole basement.
So, Bob can help you find an enjoyable activity that may be surprisingly rewarding.
All those cows are mine.
And I still enjoy doing it because there's not enough of people in today's world to realize the enjoyment out of being creative.
So you can relax here with a hobby, get advice from Bob, find treasures. If you have any money left, you might consider walking down to Grant Avenue to another cool store, Attic Records. Walk in and you know what they sell here.
Records and CDs, music of all types from every genre, every era.
Bob Bond helps his dad Fred run this family business and can explain how things are organized.
Like, we try to keep the newest things or the newly restocked things here. And then as we add things in there, we take them out of there and put them up here or just in the regular sections. So sometimes things you have to look in a few different places just for the simple reason that we just don't have the space to keep everything in one place. We opened up in November of 1980. My dad started it, and originally it started as baseball cards, beer cans, and records, which at that time it was up the street, probably about a mile or so, and it was at a lot smaller place, which we outgrew that in about 6 months, and then came down here and started with just the one storefront. And since then, we've expanded into four storefronts. You're looking for Hank Williams? We specialize in everything. That's our problem, is we try to have everything that people want, whether it's something that just came out this week or whether it's something from the 1920s. We still sell a lot of CDs, but more and more and more every day, vinyl is becoming the thing that people want. I'll never get tired of it. I love it so much. I, you know, come to work early in the morning before we open, and I stay later after we close also. We try to keep prices reasonable, you know, to where people could come in, you know, they see what they're getting, and it's things that may be a little bit more affordable.
While we were shooting outside the attic, we happened to meet a young man named Jeremy Fallon, who's grown up around here and who appreciates the murals painted on the attic.
Well, as I walk past, I always look at them. I like the Kiss guys and the four dudes.
Sorry?
The four dudes on there.
Who they are?
No, actually. No.
Those are the Beatles.
I only see them when they're old.
Well, young Jeremy was willing to give us a little list of some of his favorite spots around town, including Scott's Barber Shop.
Papa always go to get my hair cut. He got a snake that's dead in a jar. I always look at it. Sometimes I get free haircuts because I'm like, my dad knows him so much.
What else does Jeremy like?
Element Church. That's where I go to church, right across the street. Yetters, my favorite place to get my candy and stuff. Order myself some ice cream, vanilla. It's my favorite.
Yes, Yetters is a Millvale landmark owned and run by Ed Carr, everybody calls him Butch, and his wife, Arlene Yetter Carr.
Yetters is a combination of candy, ice cream, deli, lunch counter. That's enough to keep you busy.
We opened December 13th, 1950. We were a convenience store that made our own candy and ice cream.
And they've always had loyal customers, like Harry Dillmore.
I was born and raised here, but I live in Avalon now. Yeah, still come over here.
The Yetter's first ice cream and candy store was farther up on North Avenue, where the signs still say Regis Steedles. Family changes caused Arlene's father to come here to Grant Avenue and found this store while his brother's family stayed up at the other.
They did their thing and we did our thing. We made our own ice cream. They made their own ice cream. They made their own candy. We made our own candy. I mean, this town kept two candy stores going. And not now.
And everybody in Millvale knows that Yetters still makes their own candy in the rooms at the back of the store. That's where we met Judy Warwick and Patty Cerny as they were working on the candy assembly line.
We cover everything in chocolate.
But basically, it's a bottom machine. And without that, you have no bottoms to your candy.
Patty puts the pretzels on, they come down the belt, and then they go through the chocolate, get coated, and they come through on a bouncer. It's called the bouncer. It shakes the excess chocolate off. Then it will come through the drying tunnel, and then I take them off and put them in the boxes or bags or whatever we make.
This scene may remind you of a famous I Love Lucy episode.
When you first start here, it seems like it's going that fast.
That's what they call us, me and her, Ethel and Lucy. That's what they call us.
You just have to get used to working with it, you know, with that.
Everything's good, everything. I love the turtles. Our turtles are awesome. That's my favorite.
Raisin clusters, I really like raisin clusters.
I like caramel. I really like the caramels because he makes them so creamy.
These are chocolate roses, and they are, we're going to have them for Mother's Day. We have a Mother Downs too, but we're working towards Mother's Day.
There's that sort of wonderful energy here that seems to be crucial in a small family-owned business.
It's in your blood. You work harder. You work harder because it's yours.
I love this place. I really been here at least 42 years. And I really enjoy it. I met so many people and they've just been so nice. And
my dad told me that we would last. I don't know. He died 40 some years ago, but
our dad told her Yetters will outlive Isleys. I said, wow. Isleys are pretty doggone popular. But there's none left, huh? As long as we can stay healthy, we'll keep doing it. But it's fun. I really do enjoy it. We've been lucky.
Oh, we're all lucky that Millvale is full of surprises. You know, I haven't even mentioned St. Nicholas Church on the hillside near Route 28. In this church are the unusual and amazing murals painted by Croatian artist Maxo Vanka. People come from all over the world to see these works of art, and Mass is still celebrated here on Saturdays at 6. Now, over on Lincoln Avenue, musicians of many sorts from all over make their way to Mr. Small's, a theater, recording studios, and video production facilities in the buildings that once were St. Anne's Church. On Grant Avenue, in what was formerly a funeral parlor, there's now an exotic bird store called Pretty Birds, run by a guy named Don Blosser.
We do boarding, grooming, we sell food, we sell toys, cages, and birds.
Oh, you're so beautiful.
That is an caique. I love people, and I love my birds better. Birds are better than people. Isn't that right? Say yes. Say yes. Don't make a liar out of me. Okay, that's a good boy.
Down by 28, there's a red brick building that used to be a brewery, and just a short block away, there's a new structure that houses a new little business. We met Steve Bordeaux there.
The name of the business is Dry Log Brewing Company. It was started in 2009. Basically, we're a brewery. We're going for the old Belgian monastic style, but we mix it up. We kind of throw in some German, some European influences, the United Kingdom. Everything is done here. The brewing, the bottling, the kegging, and actually the serving of the beer, it's all done in this one small area.
They've named one of their beers, Simon Gertie, after the turncoat whose family's name is on nearby Gertie's Run. Millvale connections. And if you spend a day in Millvale, you may decide to make a connection with this place.
It's called Grant Bar, but it's actually a restaurant, yes.
And why do people keep coming to Grant Bar?
For shrimp, for homemade pies, for friendly service, for nice atmosphere.
Food is our specialty. Main one is shrimp. We have a marinated steak, which is number two seller. Go to liver and onions. We go to club sandwiches. Yeah, we got the whole works.
We've had turtle soup for 70 years. That's one of our staples, turtle soup, fresh turtle soup.
That's Frank Ruzumberka. His family started all this, and they're still involved.
Well, it opened in the first week of October 1933. My dad had just this bar. He would open up at 4 in the morning, and he would have a steam table right here behind the bar. And my mother had a kitchen upstairs. And we had a dummy elevator. The only way you could get the food down was to a dummy elevator. And it worked. She made chicken upstairs, and it grew and grew, and all the time the Ruzumberkas owned it.
There are now some new co-owners, longtime employees, including Chef Rory Ben, who offered to show us how they make their popular fried shrimp.
We cut them backwards. Everybody else cuts them from this side. We cut them the other side, butterfly them out. The trick is get the flour down inside there. And get the ball of your hand right in the crevice and push just enough to hear a crack. That keeps them nice and big.
I'm a believer that we're probably one of the first restaurants in the city of Pittsburgh to serve shrimp.
Did you see the little shimmy? There's a little shimmy when you put them down into the stuff.
Only thing I can say that has changed in the last 50 years was we used to use lard for shortening, and now we're not allowed, but they still come out beautiful.
It comes out golden brown, just like you see here. You gotta dump it in this sauce that we make ourselves. It's crispy, it's not greasy, tender, tasteful.
And they come in every day for our shrimp.
Yes, and Frank comes in early every day too.
I make pies every day.
He's here every morning at 6 till 10 making pies.
My coconut cream pie, Pittsburgh Magazine named it the Pie of Pittsburgh.
Banana cream, chocolate cream, fresh apple pies, yeah.
And everybody wants to know while I'm working, and I tell them I'm not working, I'm retired. This is my hobby. I love to do what I do, and I do it good. Peel the bottom. Is that fresh? Still warm. It's apple, fresh apples. I go out to Sorgles and buy it. I mean, they get them from New York. Yeah, so. And this is just a pie bit. We do everything the hard way, but the right way. You know what I mean?
I just know that Grant Bar is probably one of the best classically Pittsburgh restaurants around. But all these older businesses in Millvale have stories. And some of the best ones are about the floods here.
The year 04 was the worst flood we've had. That was worse than the 36 flood.
September 17, 2004.
It was during Millvale Days, one of our real big events. It came really quick. I was upstairs in my office. Somebody ran up the steps and said, oh my God, there's a tidal wave coming down the street.
Yeah, off of Gertie's Run.
Gertie's Run is right underneath here.
When he came in, I was walking in the waiting area. I had water up to my knees. I said, maybe it's time to go.
We're standing here with all the merchandise on the floor trying to keep our balance.
I knew when the water was over the parking meters, we were in trouble.
People don't realize that a flash flood, the water comes bellowing down the street is what happens.
We helped take stuff out of the cellar while the water was rising.
There was 5 feet of water out there.
The water was higher than the counter.
It was 16 feet from the basement up.
The water was about 4 foot in here.
It was up underneath, right underneath that shelf.
But that high there.
We had 4 foot of water all through the main stores. We lost millions of records, millions of CDs.
When the water went down, we were shocked to come down and see what we saw.
And when we came down here and saw what we saw, it was just, you just wanted to cry.
Everything was gone.
It was covered in mud.
I like to say we put down our spatulas and we picked up hammers.
We had to rebuild everything from scratch, tear down all the walls, tear out the floors.
And people just, they would stop and say, you have to open. They made you feel like you had to.
People put money in our mailboxes.
We did what we could do, and we worked until we slowly got it back to one piece again.
The bar is the only thing left from the flood, before the flood. Everything else is new.
The soda fountain was still the only original piece.
And when it comes down to it, it's the community, it's the people that work with me. I'm very, very fortunate.
For us, we were pretty doggone lucky with people that helped.
And who did it? Was all my workers.
We were closed a year and we lost an entire candy season.
We were closed for 8 months.
And it took us years to rebuild the stock.
All the customers came back.
There is a resurrection afterwards.
I think it brought the community together.
We really count on each other's strength to get back together.
It was really something.
It was terrible and trying, but now even the tales of survival are part of the charm of this place called Millvale.
If you start downtown, you go on Route 28, what's the first town? Millvale.
Accessible to downtown, Lawrenceville, everything is right here.
It's actually a good neighborhood. There's no killings here.
We all root for each other. We all help each other.
I used to deliver papers to almost everybody in the town.
Because it's still a town that there are still a lot of independent businesses.
And I couldn't wait to get done, to get my peanut cluster.
It's a cute little town, and I just feel like it's me. It's me.
I like it here.
Yeah, it's great.
Millvale's okay.
It's Pittsburgh and a lot of other stuff is made possible by the Buell Foundation, serving southwestern Pennsylvania since 1927, and by PNC, celebrating Pittsburgh's past, present, and future at the PNC Legacy Project exhibit in downtown Pittsburgh.